The topography of the eastern U.S., shown on the left, is dominated by the coastline stretching from Maine to Florida, and also by the Appalachian Mountains, which run from southwest to northeast, approximately 100 to 250 miles inland from the coast. The Great Lakes are located further to the north and west and play a large role in patterns of average annual snowfall observed across the area. The average annual snowfall, shown on the right, varies widely across the area. Snowfall generally increases from south to north, but with lots of variations. For example, one can easily see the enhancement of the snowfall east and southeast of the Great Lakes on these maps, and also the enhancement of snowfall at higher elevations. Looking at the average annual snowfall for the northeast U.S. a little more closely, it's easy to see features associated with topography. For example, higher elevation snowfall along the west slopes of the Appalachian Mountains from southwest Pennsylvania down through eastern West Virginia can be easily seen. The snow belts east of Lakes Erie and Ontario show up easily, and areas of relatively high snowfall can be seen in northeast Pennsylvania and western New England associated with higher elevations in those areas. Areas that are often downstream from higher terrain features typically see less snow. Examples that are easy to see on this slide are in central and western Maryland, south central Pennsylvania, and portions of west central New York. Cold air damming was earlier discussed with regard to topography over the western U.S., but it can also play a big role in determining precipitation and temperature patterns over the eastern U.S. A typical pattern for cold air damming over the mid-Atlantic region is shown on the left, with surface high pressure building over the Great Lakes and northeast, pushing a cold front south through the mid-Atlantic region toward Florida. In this scenario, a wedge of cold air will move down the east slopes of the Appalachian Mountains, while easterly flow along the coast will induce a coastal front near or just inland from the coast, as is shown in the middle slide. Both the coastal front and the boundary on the eastern edge of the cold air wedge can become a focus for enhanced upward vertical motion and precipitation. The slide on the right shows a frontal zone developing east of the Appalachian Mountains on the eastern edge of the cold wedge. The frontal zone would be a favored region for development of a thermally direct circulation, which could lead to enhanced precipitation near the upward branch of the circulation east of the mountains. Another scenario in which topography frequently plays a role in determining precipitation patterns over the eastern U.S. is northwest flow frequently observed in the wake of low-pressure areas moving off the east coast. The slide on the left shows trajectories associated with a northwest flow event from 2005, originating over Lake Michigan and extending southeast across high terrain areas over eastern Tennessee and western North Carolina. Results from a modeling study of a northwest flow event are shown in the middle slide. The yellow and orange colors show areas where removal of the upstream Great Lakes in the model resulted in less precipitation over the higher terrain over eastern Tennessee and western North Carolina. Most of the western slopes of the Appalachians received less snow with the lakes taken out, although interestingly there were some small-scale exceptions. There is evidence from these modeling studies that the upstream Great Lakes enhance snowfall over the mountains not only by providing a moisture source, but also by destabilizing the lower troposphere and therefore making it easier for air flows to ascend the downstream mountains, producing more precipitation. The sounding from a typical northwest flow event is shown on the right, characterized by a surface-based unstable layer, a shallow surface-based moist layer extending into the dendritic ice crystal growth layer, and capped by an inversion with dry air aloft. While many classic northwest flow events occur with dry air aloft and surface cyclones well to the east of the central Appalachians, a subset of events occur with surface cyclones moving along the east coast, which result in deeper moisture profiles. The availability of more moisture in these events can result in heavier snowfalls than in a more typical northwest flow case. Hurricane Sandy was an extreme example of this type of event, producing snowfall totals of over 2 feet in the mountains of West Virginia, North Carolina, and Tennessee. This image shows the track of Sandy along the mid-Atlantic coast. A sounding shows a layer of deep moisture at Poga Mountain on the North Carolina-Tennessee border during the event. And finally, the observed snowfall over the southern Appalachians shows terrain-enhanced snowfall of over 20 centimeters covering a large area over the higher terrain from West Virginia down to North Carolina. Another example of topography impacting snowfall amounts over the eastern U.S. can be seen in northern Vermont during northwest flow. The image on the left shows the terrain in northern Vermont. Burlington, Vermont is located in the Champlain Valley just east of Lake Champlain, while the Green Mountains rise 3,000 to 4,000 feet about 20 miles to the east. Northwest flow snow events typically produce moderate to heavy snow amounts over the mountains east of the Champlain Valley in northern and central Vermont. However, there are times when heavy snow is displaced westward over the Champlain Valley, producing heavy snowfalls in the populated areas around Burlington. The slide on the right shows the impact that blocking of the flow can have on snow in northern Vermont and other areas when the flow is oriented perpendicular to terrain. In the image at the top, the flow is blocked by terrain and heavy snow can fall upstream from the ridges. In the center, the blocking is less pronounced and heaviest snow falls on top of the ridge. And at the bottom, there is no blocking. The flow is able to move freely up and over the ridge and heaviest snow will fall over the top of the ridge and into downstream valleys. Recall that the Froude number can be a good way to quantify the blocking potential of the flow for winter storms in complex terrain, like the one shown on the previous slide, with values less than 1 indicating blocked flow, while values greater than 1 indicate flow that is able to ascend up and over terrain barriers. The graph on the left shows that for northwest flow, significant snowfall can occur at Burlington as long as the Froude number is less than 1, the flow is blocked, and snow falls upstream of the Green Mountain Ridge barrier. When the Froude number is greater than 1 and flow is able to go up and over the terrain, significant snowfall in Burlington does not occur. By contrast, Jay Peak, which is located at the top of the Green Mountain Barrier, experiences its heaviest snowfalls over a wider range of Froude numbers. The utility of considering the effects of blocked flow via the Froude number for anticipating snowfall patterns in terrain was also demonstrated recently in a study for Northeast Pennsylvania. The image on the left shows that the terrain around Wilkes-Barre and Scranton in Northeast Pennsylvania is characterized by a broad southwest to northeast oriented valley surrounded by higher terrain. The image on the right compares the range of Froude number values for low dependence cases, which are defined as cases when the valley gets similar snowfall amounts as nearby higher terrain, and for high dependence cases, defined as cases when the higher terrain gets substantially more snowfall than the valley. It can be seen that low dependence cases were associated with low Froude numbers, implying high stability and light winds, while high dependence cases were associated with higher Froude numbers, lower stability, and or stronger winds.
An example of flow channeling impacting snowfall amounts in the eastern United States can be seen from this study for the eastern Mohawk Valley and mid-Hudson Valley in eastern New York. The Mohawk-Hudson Valley convergence has been shown to enhance the snowfall in this area, which includes the highly populated area around Albany, New York. In this case, a northwest flow gradient around the backside of low-pressure areas departing off the east coast is frequently associated with convergent flow with northerly channel flow down the Hudson Valley, converging with westerly channel flow down the Mohawk Valley. The flow chart on the right was developed by the forecast office in Albany to help forecasters anticipate these events. The flow chart starts by asking whether a low pressure will be east and south of the area and has a check for the strength of the pressure gradient. Checks are also done for weak synoptic scale forcing for upward motion, weak cold advection, and whether moisture is trapped under a low-level inversion or isothermal layer. If all these factors are in place, the checklist indicates that Mohawk-Hudson convergence is likely.
Sometimes even minor topographic features can have substantial impacts on precipitation patterns. The images on this slide show results from a study of the impact of precipitation patterns of differential friction near coastlines as well as ranges of small hills over central Long Island and southern Connecticut during a widespread rainfall event. The elevation of these hills is only a couple hundred feet, yet total precipitation from radar estimates at the top right and rain gauge data on the bottom right show clear maximum of precipitation just inland from the coast over the low hills on Long Island and Connecticut, with a minima in between along the coastline and over Long Island Sound. High-resolution modeling studies for this case indicated that a gravity wave may have formed over the hills in central Long Island, producing upward motion over the hills and subsidence to the north over Long Island Sound. High-resolution models and even mean fields from high-resolution ensembles will account for topography in their QPFs. This slide shows QPF from the 3-kilometer HER model for a blizzard over central New York on March 14, 2017 on the left. Note that higher snowfall totals are indicated over the higher terrain north and south of the Mohawk Valley, with a minima of snowfall forecast in the Mohawk Valley. The snowfall from the 3 to 4 kilometer NCAR ensemble shown on the right also indicates maxima over the higher terrain of the Pocono Mountains in northeast Pennsylvania and the Catskill Mountains in eastern New York. rigorous verification studies on the accuracy of the impacts of snowfall by terrain in high-resolution models are lacking for the eastern U.S. as of 2017. However, informal surveys of forecasters from the area indicate that high-resolution models may have a tendency to place too much precipitation over higher elevations in the area and sometimes extend too much precipitation downstream from terrain barriers. This lesson is focused mainly on the impacts of topography on snowfall, but there are many other impacts that could be discussed that time limitations will keep us from talking about in any detail here. These include lake effect snowfall, which is covered in another lesson, phone downsloping winds in eastern Tennessee, freezing rain in the Carolinas, rain snow lines along coastal fronts, topographically forced heavy rainfall and flooding, and coastal flooding. So to summarize, the topography over the eastern U.S., while not as pronounced as what is found in the west, is still more than enough to produce a myriad of topographically enhanced winter weather hazards. Many of these hazards occur on small scales. We've covered some of them in this lesson, but forecasters will need to learn and experience these impacts for their own county warning areas. It's safe to say that just about every county warning area has its own topographically forced impacts on winter weather. And local experience and expertise will be critical for effective forecast warnings and decision support for these types of events. And finally, for anyone that wants to learn more about this topic, here is a list of references.